Abe Lincoln and the STINCOLNS proudly present TV Tards. It is our love quadrangle. Accompanying this tape may be a small booklet. Although not necessary for the enjoyment of the tape, it may enhance your listening pleasure. Now, open your guidebooks to page 1. At the sound of each chime, turn the page. So friends, sit back and relax as you venture into the minds and lives of our retardededs. Edits. We join our retarded friends at the bowling alley. Each weekend, Mrs. Penny and Doug take a group of 20 retards for a social outing. This weekend they will bowl on Saturday and swim on Sunday. Our main characters, Benjamin, Robert, Jonathan and Sally, sit at lane number 1. Mrs. Penny helps Sally put on her shoes as Doug places 2 bowling balls before the retards. There you are. Now remember, these are very heavy. Be careful. Doug and Sally rush off to another group of retards.
Hey, I bowl to strike Sally,
chirps Robert. Sally, who is short and pregnant, slouches and stares at the floor with glazed over eyes. Jonathan shuffles over to the bowling lane and lifts one of the 8-pound balls.
It's heavy. Watch me go.
Jonathan's ball rolls immediately into the gutter. Benjamin hits his head on the score table. Bam! He is wearing a leather padded helmet. Benjamin screams.
I'm hungry.
While Benjamin screams and bangs his head, bam bam bam, Jonathan bowls another gutter ball. Robert moves next to Sally and puts his arm affectionately around her slumped shoulders.
Hey, hello,
says Robert. Sally does not respond.
Hey, I bowl you strike. Sally, hello Sally, we friends. I bowl strike you for Sally. Mrs. Penny ties my shoe. Benjamin hungry.
Robert continues his one-sided conversation with Sally as John bowls yet another gutter ball. Doug runs to Benjamin and holds him still. Benjamin, warns Doug, stop hitting your head on the table. It is bad. Very bad. Don't do it.
Hungry,
whines Benjamin.
Hungry.
Benjamin smiles, revealing a twisted mess of rotten teeth. Blood begins to dribble out of his nose. Damn, exclaims Doug. Mrs. Penny, can you come here a second? Benjamin has another bloody nose. I'll get some napkins and a hot dog. He says he's hungry. Mrs. Penny sits next to Benjamin and tries to calm him down.
Hungry.
Chants Benjamin. John bowls his 4th gutter ball.
Hey, Sally, you have baby. See?
Robert points to Sally's bulging midsection. Sally's pockmarked, distorted face shows no emotion. A long thin strand of viscous drool connects her face to the ground.
Hey, our baby's fun. You like to have baby, Sally. I like to have baby. Hey, we friends. I bow strike.
Doug washes Benjamin's bloody face. Mrs. Penny stands up to make an announcement. Okay, everyone listen up. Jonathan, stop bowling for a moment and come here.
Hey, come dear, Jonathan.
Mimics Robert. Thank you, Robert. Now, you four are a team. Benjamin, Jonathan, Robert and Sally. Since you're a team, you will need a team name. Okay. What would you like your team name to be? Does anyone have an idea? What are some other team names you've heard? Jonathan, can you think of a team name? Jonathan scratches his head.
I like Wheel of Fortune.
Mrs. Penny claps her hands and laughs. That's a very good idea. Does anyone else have another name? Or would you like to be the Wheel of Fortune? Robert blurts out.
Hey, hockey hockey.
This is bowling, not hockey, Robert. Smiles Mrs. Penny.
Hey, we play bowling. Hey, hockey players.
Would you like your team name to be the hockey players? Robert shakes his head in a negative gesture. Okay, I guess your team name will be the Wheel of Fortune. I'm going over to the other groups. You can all begin bowling whenever you're ready. Good luck. Mrs. Penny and Doug walk away. Benjamin begins shaking.
We raiders, raiders, raiders.
Benjamin smashes his helmet against the table again. Bam. Then he jumps up and continues to shout raiders. Jonathan picks up a bowling ball and prepares to throw it into the gutter when Benjamin hits him from behind. Jonathan falls into the gutter.
Raiders, 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 raiders.
Shouts Benjamin wildly. Jonathan mumbles as he staggers back to his feet.
The Wheel of Fortune. Raiders.
Benjamin knocks Jonathan down again, then runs over to Robert and Sally. Robert cowers behind Sally and nods his head submissively.
Hey, yes, Benjamin. Hey,
we raiders.
Hey,
I bow strike for raiders.
Hey,
yes, Sally.
Raiders.
Benjamin takes Jonathan's bowling ball and throws it into the gutter. Then he jumps headlong into the gutter and begins banging his head on the waxed floor. Bam, 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 bam. Doug appears and drags Benjamin back to his seat. Benjamin, listen to me. If you keep this up, we cannot bring you on our fun trips. Do you hear me? You have to behave yourself. You like to have fun, don't you? You don't want to stay at home, do you?
Yep, yep. I like to have fun. Raiders, yep.
Then calm down. Just calm down. Okay.
I like to have fun.
Good. This is your last warning.
I like to have fun. Raiders.
Jonathan bowls another gutter ball. Benjamin jumps up and hits Robert.
Sally's my baby. Mine.
Robert scurries away. Benjamin pushes Sally over and begins beating her.
Raiders. I want raiders. Sally, I want raiders. Hello, I'm a retarded. Watch me go. I like rock music. Raiders go fast, raiders. Hey, Benjamin. You don't do that.
Hey, Sally, where my strike?
Make strike for Sally.
Hey, don't.
Hey, we raiders.
Says Robert from a safe distance. Jonathan pulls another gutter ball. Doug pulls Benjamin off Sally and drags him out of the bowling alley. As they leave the building, Benjamin screams.
Raiders! Raiders! Raiders, 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 Raiders!
Our friends live together at the Hall of Justice, a home for the mentally handicapped. It is there that they while away most of their hours watching television shows or playing games. Dinner is usually the highlight of the day. The long line of retarded people moves slowly into the dining room. Robert, Benjamin, Jonathan and Sally sit together at every meal. Tonight is hamburger night. Robert loves hamburgers more than anything in the world. To the other retards, this is just another meal, but to Robert, it is a spiritual experience.
Hey, hamburger time. Here I come, Mr. Hamburger. Hey, you make me feel so good. You my favorite food. Hey, hamburger.
Benjamin hits his head on the table and laughs hysterically. Bam bam.
I hungry, hungry, hungry. Food now. Hungry food.
Shouts Benjamin. Jonathan picks a large booger out of his nose. He turns to Sally and wipes it on her shirt. Sally stares into oblivion.
What? We? Eat?
Asks Jonathan.
Hey, hamburger. Hamburger, hamburger on a bun. Hey, it best food in world. Hamburgers, hooray.
Mrs. Penny places a large tray by the retards. She sets a plate of food and plastic eating utensils in front of each tard. Robert cheers enthusiastically. We all know how much you like hamburgers, Robert. Says Mrs. Penny.
Hey, my hamburger. Hey, they taste great. I eat hamburger too. Hungry, hungry, hungry.
Okay, Benjamin. You can eat a hamburger too. Remember to say grace before you eat. Enjoy.
Jonathan said grace.
Says Jonathan.
No, Sally Raider. Hey, hamburgers taste great. Oh God. Please. Hey, hamburgers are food. Hamburgers are great. Hamburgers, I want great hamburgers, cause I like hamburgers.
Robert, Benjamin and Jonathan commence feasting on the soggy burgers. Sally remains silent and motionless. Sally is a fat, an ugly, retarded bitch. Benjamin drops his hamburger to the floor. He hits Jonathan and grabs Robert's hamburger.
Hey, hamburger!
Cries Robert. Benjamin laughs and mutilates Robert's hamburger. Jonathan attempts to pick his nose and eat at the same time. Mrs. Penny walks over to see what the commotion is about.
Hey, my hamburger! Hey, Benjamin is not eating hamburger! Hey, eat mine!
Benjamin laughs so hard that snot shoots out of his nose and into Sally's hair. He hits the table with his fists and chants.
Raiders.
Okay, Benjamin. You are the raiders. It's not polite to steal other people's food. I want you to apologize to Robert for taking his hamburger.
I sorry, Robert. We raiders.
That's better. Now let's all be friends. Jonathan, don't pick your nose while you're eating.
Booger. My nose has booger. I had nose. Help me.
I think you'll be just fine by yourself, Jonathan. Now everyone just calm down and eat your food. I'll get you another hamburger, Robert.
Hey, hamburger. Hey, thank you, Mrs. Penny. I love you. Hey, hamburger, great. I love hamburger.
As soon as Mrs. Penny is gone, Benjamin stands up to make an announcement.
Sally have bathroom. I help Sally Raiders. We go bathroom. Bye.
Benjamin takes Sally's limp hand and leads her out of the dining hall. They walk into the boys' bathroom. Benjamin pushes Sally into a stall and locks the door behind them.
Hello, I like Sally.
Benjamin pushes Sally into a kneeling position over the toilet. He then pulls down her sweatpants and extra-large underwear. Sally's face bobs inches above the toilet water as Benjamin rapes her fat pimply ass. The TV room at the Hall of Justice was always bustling with activity. TV was the main source of entertainment in the retards' lives. They each had their favorite shows. Due to Benjamin's dominant personality, the TV was usually tuned to his favorite channel, the Home Shopping Network. However, Benjamin retired early this night, leaving Robert, Jonathan, Sally and others to watch Jeopardy! Composers for 300. Alex, says the TV contestant. Composers for 300. His works included the Third Symphony, Choral Symphony, Eureka. Sally immediately popped in.
Who was Ludwig van Beethoven?
That is correct, announced Alex Trebek, the game show host. I'll take sports for 500, please. He scored 100 points in a basketball game on March 2, 1962.
Who is Will Chamberlain?
Barked Sally, as the TV contestant thought the other retards tried their luck.
Hey, Cassius Clay. Barney.
Mumbled Jonathan. I'm sorry. The correct answer was, who was Will Chamberlain? Next category. International currency for 300. This is the unit of currency that will buy you dinner in Iraq, Jordan, Tunisia and Yugoslavia.
What is the dinar?
States Sally calmly. Wayne, a severely disabled retard suddenly speaks up.
Hey, buddy!
Ow!
Hello there!
Ow!
Many people have commented on the similarity of Wayne's voice to that of a parrot. The TV contestant answers incorrectly. The correct answer was what is the dinar? Next category. Contiki ref material for 1000 Alex. The answer is the kind of wood used to make the Contiki raft. Before Alex finishes stating the question, Robert blurts out.
Hey, Bruce.
Sally answers.
What is balsa?
Once again, the TV contestant misses the correct answer. I'm sorry, the correct answer was what is balsa? Contiki raft materials for 800 Alex. During the marital ritual, these colorful feathers that adorned the Contiki rafts came from this type of bird. Sally says,
what is a chicken?
With a burst of energy, Jonathan jumps up and hits the TV. It flashes then goes to static. The Tards are amazed. For the next 10 minutes the captive audience watches as mysterious images form in the chaotic static. Eventually Sally experiences a Parkinsonian tremor which develops into a full-blown grand mal seizure. Sally bounces off her chair in waves of muscle spasms. She writes out the seizure as the other retards continue to stare at the TV static. Mrs. Penny rushes in with a hypodermic needle and turns off the TV. On this sad but typical note, TV room activities were disbanded for the evening.
Hey, morning. Hey, wake up. Hey, hello.
Robert wandered aimlessly through the hallways at 6 a.m.
Hey, I wake up for swimming. Hey, fish eat in my tummy swim. Hey, wake up, swim.
8 hours later the retards are on the bus and headed for a swimming pool. Benjamin, Jonathan, Robert and Sally sit in the very back of the bus. Robert kisses Sally's cheek and puts his arm around her while Benjamin slaps Jonathan in the adjacent seat.
No, Benjamin. No, it, you, it, me, we, swim, raiders, 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 raiders.
Cackles Benjamin as he continues to thrash Jonathan.
I like Sally. My penis smells like poopy. Watch me go.
Shortly thereafter, the bus arrives at the pool. An hour later the retards are finally in the water.
It wet? My penis wet?
Shouts Benjamin.
Penis. Smell. Poopy. I. Make. Poopy. In. Pants.
Mimics Jonathan. Benjamin and Jonathan. Those aren't nice words. Don't say them. Mrs. Penny leads Sally through the shallow area. Jonathan, come here. Hold Sally's hand. I'll be back in a few minutes.
I. Hold. Hand.
Jonathan swims over. Mrs. Penny climbs out of the pool.
Sally. Hand. Hello. Over. Here.
Sally.
I. Hold. Hand.
Jonathan leads Sally to the edge of the pool. He pushes her against the concrete and rapes her while the retards swim back and forth. As Jonathan finishes pumping Sally full of his seminal fluids, Robert approaches the pair.
Hey, swim like fish. Hello. Hey, we retarded. I want wet like rain. Hey, I like water. Water is wet. Sally, hello. Sally is wet. Water is wet. I like Sally. We friend. I hold Sally hand. See? Hey, Benjamin think crater's best. He won't give Sally present. Hey, Benjamin likes Sally. Hey, I like Sally. I like hamburger. Hey, they're great. We give Sally present. Sally smell bad. Sally have baby. See? Hey, Sally my baby. Hey, we friend. I hold Sally and see.
Benjamin splashes the three content retards.
Raiders, raiders, rar 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 Go team. Hello, Benjamin. I hold Sally and see.
Benjamin splashes water into Jonathan's face. Jonathan coughs violently and knocks over Sally. She floats face down in the water until Robert helps her up.
Hey, there Sally, you stand up. Hey, I help you, wee friend.
Benjamin, stop splashing. Mrs. Penny jumps back into the water and takes Sally away from Robert. All three of you go to the locker rooms and put your clothes back on. We're going home. I'll take care of Sally.
Hey, we swim. Hey, put clothes on like fish. Retarded. Benjamin, splash, face, water.
Mrs. Penny repeats. Go on. Go to the locker rooms, and put your clothes back on. Don't forget to dry yourself before you put on your clothes. And don't forget your bathing suits either. Benjamin, Jonathan and Robert find their way to the locker rooms. Benjamin tugs at his helmet in vain. Jonathan and Robert towel themselves dry in a surprisingly normal manner.
Hey, dry.
Announced Robert.
Hello, Robert. Dry. Sally. Friend. Raiders. Go. Fast. Benjamin. Raiders. Win. Raiders.
Barks Benjamin as he runs around naked and slams his head against locker doors.
Hey, you bad, Benjamin. Hey, Mrs. Penny say you bad. No like Benjamin, Sally like me. Hey, wee friend. Hey, Benjamin hit head. Hit hard. Hey, ouch. Benjamin, Raiders, win, what, we, do, hey, clothes.
Robert manages to put his loose pants on backwards.
Benjamin, eat, hamburger, not, hamburger. Hey, hamburger is great.
Doug enters the locker room with another group of retards. Stop hitting the locker, Benjamin. I'll help you put on your clothes. Everyone else get a towel and dry yourselves. The retards wander around the room randomly bumping into one another. Benjamin smashes his helmet into another locker. Doug grabs Benjamin by the shoulders and shakes him. Damn it, Benjamin. You stupid little shit. Quit hitting your head. Stop it. Do you understand me? Stop hitting your head. Benjamin laughs. What's so fucking funny? It's not funny. Hitting your head like that hurts. And it's not funny at all. Don't you know that? Didn't you ever learn that hitting your head hurts? Why are you so damn stupid? Put on your clothes. You retarded shit.
Doug, Matt, Benjamin, laugh, funny, stupid, retard. Hey, stupid retard eat hamburger. Hey, Benjamin is stupid retarded. Hey, I like hamburger.
The lives of retarded people are fairly bland. Each day blends into the next until linear time degenerates into a more basic cyclic pattern. The retarded way of life revolves around breakfast, lunch and dinner. It is interspersed with occasional outings to the zoo and the more frequent sexual innuendo. Who knows what it's like to be retarded but the retards themselves? Does a retard have free will? Do we? Perhaps free will? As does beauty, exists only in the eyes of the beholder. Though we may look down at the mentally handicapped with our arch precious sarcasm and call them derogatory names and smirk behind their backs, how do we know they do not do the same? Could there be an evil side behind the happy facade of myopia and physical disabilities? Could those tards be working on some terrible plan to eradicate us? Their conspiracy would be so perfect. We would have no suspicion until it was too late and the retards ruled the planet. Fortunately, as night falls again at the halls of justice, there are no signs of armed mobilization. Benjamin, Robert, and Jonathan drift off to sleep as the day's memories of eating and swimming quickly fade away to make room for the next day's activities. During the early morning hours, Jonathan is awakened. He hears a squeaking noise. His retarded sense of adventure brings him fully awake. Jonathan sets off to investigate the mysterious sound. He shuffles through the hallways until he reaches the door to Sally's room. Jonathan places his ear to the door and listens. There is definitely a repetitive squeaking noise emanating from within the room. He opens the door. Doug looks up in shock. Damn, get out of here, Jonathan. It's late, you should be in bed, not wandering around.
You, Sally, naked, we, friends, why, you, naked?
Doug gets off Sally and puts on his clothes while Jonathan stares. After quickly dressing, Doug covers Sally's passive body and leads Jonathan out of the room. Go back to sleep. I was just making sure that Sally was feeling good. Okay. Good night. Jonathan steps back into his room and Doug closes the door.
Robert! Robert!
Jonathan nudges Robert's shoulder.
Hey, wake up! What you want? Hey, I sleep now at night. Robert, Robert, Sally, is, friend, help, bed. Hey, Sally, hamburger.
Benjamin falls off his bed to join the late night conversation.
Hello. We, help. Sally, it, dark, hurry.
The retards wander out of the room and head towards Sally's room. It is perfectly silent. Benjamin giggles as Robert opens the door and walks inside. Sally lays motionless in her bed. Robert pats her on the head.
Hey, Sally, we go. Hey, we friends. Hello. Hey, we go get hamburger. Hey, they great.
Robert helps Sally stand up. Benjamin and Jonathan watch nervously.
It dark we sleep we raiders sleep raiders raiders raid.
Robert walks Sally to the door.
Hey, we get hamburger. Hey.
Help Sally, friend.
Hey, raiders get hamburger. Great.
The four retards sneak out into the hallway and out of the building. Led by Robert and Sally, they walk along desolate suburban streets and arrive at a well-lit gas station. Sitting at pump number 12 is a brand new Lincoln Town Car. The doors are unlocked and the motor is running.
Hey, hamburger. Hey, we go fast in car.
Robert helps Sally into the front passenger seat as Jonathan and Benjamin struggle into the back. Robert climbs into the driver's seat and smiles. He is a retarded.
Hey, seatbelt save lives.
Robert clicks his seatbelt into place. Sally stares out the window and a furious commotion ensues in the backseat as Benjamin tries to rape Jonathan. Robert presses a random object and the car moves forward. the owner runs out of the building with a carton of cigarettes in hand. He screams, "Get out of my car! My car! Someone help me! Stop them! Stop!" Robert grabs the steering wheel and narrowly misses a gas pump. They bounce onto a road. Robert finds the accelerator. The car speeds ahead and moves onto an exit ramp for an interstate highway.
Fast. Cool. Hamburger. We. Help. Sally. Help. Hamburger.
Benjamin laughs. The car reaches a cruising speed of 50 kilometers per hour. Sally opens her door and falls out of the car. Robert looks over to see the empty seat as the door slams shut.
Hey, Sally. Hey, I like hamburger.
In the back seat, Benjamin succeeds in removing Jonathan's pants. Robert looks to the road just as they smash into an unprotected bridge embankment. Benjamin and Jonathan fly out of the backseat and through the front windshield. Bones and glass shatter. Blood spatters Robert's face. Benjamin and Jonathan's dead bodies lie on the hood of the smoking car. Robert begins to cry.
Hey, hamburger, hamburger.
The car ignites and deadly flames burst into existence. Robert tries to escape but forgets that he is securely fastened into the car with a seatbelt. Poison fumes and deadly heat enter Robert's lungs. He dies from asphyxiation, then his body is burned beyond recognition. This has been an Abe Lincoln and the STINCOLNS production, written by Bill Harris, spoken by Abe Lincoln, copyright 1993 Abe Lincoln and the STINCOLNS. The end.
What in there? Something in air.
Do you smell peanuts? It smell you. It smell poo be coming from poo. Peanuts is searching. The mouth is open. Preparation H inside. I'm a hoping. Teeth by peanuts. Ouch.
STINCOLNS with expressed written consent from Bill Harris and his mother.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to be better far than you are, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest
to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to be willing to give when there's no more to give, to be willing to die so that honor and justice may live. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this, that one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star.
Part, the wedding ceremony had been normal. One of the groom's old friends threw a jellyfish at the priest. Other than that, everything was fine. And now it was over. Ben and Kathy were now one in the spirit, husband and wife, for better or worse than all that other baggage. Ben and Kathy sat in the backseat of their rented limo. Kathy brushed rice out of her hair and checked her look in a mirror. Then stared out the window at passing streets. It was dark. The reception had dragged on forever. His mom had to dance with everyone twice and eventually fell down drunk. His father was afraid she'd suffered a concussion and called an ambulance. Thankfully, Kathy's relatives were all rather subdued. At least he could rest easy in the consolation that it was over. This was his wedding night. He would try to make the best of it. The limo pulled to a halt in front of an economy inn.
$39.95 a night,
mumbled Ben under his voice. His roommate had refused to vacate so that Ben could have a little privacy on his wedding night. Therefore, Ben had no other option but a cheap hotel room. That was all he could afford. Kathy had wanted a nice honeymoon vacation to celebrate the event, but Ben was about to receive his doctorate in philosophy and had lots of work to do in the coming months. They had decided to go ahead with the ceremony anyway, despite the complications. Ben held the door open and Kathy strutted into the tiny hotel lobby as her dress dragged through the mud outside. Ben paid for the room and they wasted no time in occupying it. Kathy put a quarter into a change receptacle next to the bed. This started a loud motor under the mattress which set the whole bed vibrating. She giggled, stripped off her dress and threw it across the queen-size bed. Ben had never seen a light girl naked before. It was quite a letdown. Kathy had a rather squat figure. It resembled her face. Ben tried to play along. Kathy ripped off Ben's clothes and threw him down on the bed. They had been dating for 5 years and apparently Kathy was eager to have sex. In his naive sexual debut, Ben prematurely ejaculated onto Kathy's wedding dress. Kathy tried her best to re-stimulate Ben's uncooperative organ to no avail. This left the couple with little else to do but turn on the TV. Ben's previous embarrassment was quickly pushed aside by the always pleasant and familiar face of Alex Trebek, the host of Jeopardy. Kathy hid under the covers and popped at Wild and sat nude at the edge of the bed and played along with the game show contestants. I'll take sports for 500, Alex. Alright, sports for 500. A boarded tartboard has this many segments.
What is 20?
Exclaimed Ben. The contestant on television also guesses correctly. I'll take sports for 600, Alex. Sports for 600. This man KO'd Joe Louis in 1936 and was KO'd by him in 1937. Ben instantly answered,
who is Max Schmeling?
One of the real contestants hesitated and answered, who is Cassius Clay? I'm sorry, the correct answer is who is Max Schmeling? Next category. I'll try religion for 300 please. Religion for 300. This Mormon leader was said to have had 27 wives.
Who was Brigham Young?
Asked Ben. The television contestant missed the question. Kathy poked her head out from beneath the sheets. Are you going to just sit there and watch Jeopardy on our wedding night? Ben glanced over at Kathy and grinned. The convolutions of Broca are found in this internal organ, said Alex.
What is the brain?
Answered Ben. Kathy screamed, jumped up and unplugged the TV. She was very upset. Her small breasts were red with rage. Ben smiled innocently. Kathy charged at Ben and knocked him off the bed. As they hit the ground, there was a sickening crack as Ben's left leg broke. By the time the paramedics had arrived, Ben had a monster erection and was ready for action. However, Kathy was feeling a little guilty about breaking her husband's leg. Over the next 9 months, Ben's broken leg healed and Kathy's baby grew from a tiny zygote into a 10-pound fetus. The couple never attempted sex after the less than satisfying wedding night experience. Although Ben failed to penetrate his bride and therefore never actually deposited any sperm directly into Kathy's fertile womb, he still believed that the child within her was of his genetic heritage. Kathy had claimed that as the paramedics took him to the hospital, she had become terrified by the possibility that he would die. In a desperate rush to save his lineage, she snatched a hypodermic needle from the medical supplies in the ambulance. With this, she extracted a small amount of Ben's nearly dried semen from the fabric of her wedding dress. After mixing the sperm with a little warm water, she artificially inseminated herself in the hospital bathroom while Ben was in x-rays. Since those initial exciting moments of their marriage, things had gone downhill fast. They managed to get their own apartment 3 months after their wedding. Ben's graduation plans had fallen apart. His proposal had been rejected for the third time and his future study at the University of Massachusetts was unlikely to continue. Ben sat on the couch and stared at the TV. It was almost time for Jeopardy. Kathy walked into the room. Her maternity clothes were stretched to maximum capacity. She handed Ben a plate of French toast. There's your dinner. Enjoy it. Once I have our baby, you can cook me dinner.
Okay,
said Ben. Kathy sat next to Ben. Did you remember to pick up my dry cleaning?
I'll get it tomorrow,
said Ben. I need it tomorrow morning. Did you remember to buy trash bags? I didn't see any. You know we need trash bags. This place is a pigsty. What have you been doing all day? Did you talk to your committee about substituting a fourth proposal? Did you look into collecting unemployment? What about welfare? How are we going to buy food for our baby? When are you going to get your act together, Ben? Ben? Are you listening to me?
Hush,
said Ben.
Jeopardy is about to begin.
They both watched as Alex Trebek takes command of the screen. After 10 minutes of inane humor and commercials, the game began. I'll take spices for 100, please. Spices for 100. This plant is revered by the lovers of the stinky rose.
What is garlic?
Answer then without pause. You are correct. I'll take board games for 200, Alex. Board games for 200. This game derives its name from the Persian word for king.
What is chess?
Kathy began to hyperventilate. I'll try pop music for 100, please. Pop music for 100. This band sang the original version of Mellow Yellow. Kathy grasped onto Ben's arm. Ack, Ben, help me, I think this is it. I think I'm going into labor. My water just broke. I can feel it. Ben looked down to see liquid dribbling from between Kathy's legs onto the couch and floor. Without a hint of emotion, he answered.
Who is Tony Ben?
Help me. You have to drag me to the hospital. Kathy struggled to her feet and dragged Ben away from the television. Hurry up. Don't forget that this is your baby too. The hospital is only 5 minutes away. I can make it, I can make it. I know I can make it. Hurry, hurry, let's go. And with that they left the apartment, then watched television in the hospital waiting room. It was 3 in the morning when a bedraggled doctor appeared. He looked around the empty room then approached Ben cautiously. Mr. Ben Bradley. Ben nodded. The doctor's voice was solemn. Not what one would expect in the congratulations on becoming a father. Mr. Bradley, my name is Dr. Harris. Your wife has just delivered a baby boy. It's really too bad you couldn't have been there. I think Kathy would have benefited from your support. But at the same time I understand some people just can't stomach that situation. Don't let it bother you. Anyway, you should be with your wife. She's had a hard night. You see, your baby, your child is not as healthy as we hoped. There's nothing I can say to ease the pain that this will bring, so I'll just say it. Normally this condition is caught early in pregnancy and avoided, but not always. Your child is hydrocephalic, which means that it has an underdeveloped nervous system. If it survives, which is likely with today's improved life-saving technologies, it will at best be severely mentally handicapped. I'm sorry. Ben stood in silent shock, yet at the same time it was no big surprise. Ben always expected and usually received the worst. Dr. Harris put his arm around Ben's shoulders and led him to Kathy's hospital bed. Ben walked into the dismal room and Dr. Harris left them to be alone. Kathy's sad pale face stared up at the glowing TV. Ben watched the late night sitcom rerun with her. Did they tell you? Asked Kathy.
Yes.
Kathy whimpered for a while then went to sleep. The TV picture turned to static. Ben detached himself from the hypnotic picture and walked out of the room. He looked up the hallway and saw a sign pointing toward the maternity ward. His feet shuffled along the cool tile. He asked a nurse to see his child for a moment. The nurse hesitated then led Ben to the incubator where his child slept. The baby was hooked into numerous tubes. Machines of all types blinked around the unconscious child. Then put his face up to the glass. The newborn didn't move. After only a few minutes, the nurse took Ben's arm and insisted that he return in the morning. Ben left the hospital and drove home. It was almost morning. The sky was pink with a pre-dawn glow. He parked his car and entered the apartment building. It remained just as they had left it. Ben went to the kitchen and got a steak knife. He walked into the TV room and sat before the blank screen. With great care, he rolled up his shirt sleeve and produced a major vein in his forearm. The steak knife found its way into his flesh and cut lengthwise down his arm. The vein split open for a full 8 centimeters. Blood spurted along the path of least resistance. Ben died watching his life's blood coagulate and dry on the decrepit couch.
Two, three, four. All day I try to spell word preparation H on calculator. All day. The best I could do is spell plepacicioh. The best I could do is spell plepacicioh. But my friends spell retard, and I don't know how. We spell return on calculator, but I only spell plepacicioh on calculator. I never say anything, but when you spell return, it looks more like Gablero. Gablero. Cause he used letter R for an 8. I thought he spelled return and I laughed. But I looked at it. It spelled Gablero. On calculator, I think. Letter R isn't spelled with 8. Letter R isn't spelled with the number 8. Hair dryer dries preparation H onto mirror. What does it say? What does it say? Harp. Wipe ass at vanilla envelope. Out from ass shoots bar of soap. Do Miggy hear footsteps? First letter F. The word is harp. What is the word?
Ben Bradley PP penis is as bombardic as my dick. I beat it so hard, so hard I beat it with my big stick. I saw Ben in my dream. He whips it against the wall. Whips it hard and let out a scream. I think he hurt his thing.
Take this dog and shove it. Shove right up your nose. Shove it up your nose. Shove dog nose. Shove this dog up your nose. I don't want it, shove it up nose. Shove dog up nose. If you don't take dog, I'll spit it into your mouth. You bitch tattoo and you don't shove dog up your nose. Take this dog and shove it. Then shove preparation H up your nose and shove this down throat. Shove it right up your nose down your throat, up your nose down your throat, up your nose. Shove this talk you have up your nose, further up your nose. Take this talk and shove this, shove that into your mouth.
Bob.
Set us free. We may seem a worthy people, bound by state and steeple, but we're not. Please kill us, make us die. Well, the sun shines bright as spouses on our happy little houses. The endless joy and heartfelt bliss where our souls will ever roam. It may seem that we're content here with our love neath laughing skies. All that we ask for is a bullet between the eyes. Please kill us. Endless dark fulfills us. Please don't tease us and our breath. On the outside we are singing, but inside we'd rather be swinging in the dawn light. Please kill us, give us death. Please kill us, make it death you will us. Make us happy, set us free. We may seem a worthy people, bound by state and steeple, but we're not. Please kill us, make us die.